Good morning to each of you. Hope you had a dry trip to church. This morning I got up to go out to do my morning routine and it was raining. So, but when it rains real hard, we do rotational grazing. It rains real hard, the cows are all, were all in the barn, so I didn't need to put on the coat and go fetch them. So that's the bonus of that. Any announcements before we begin? Debbie got one to turn over here. October Ripples are in your mailbox, and for newcomers, you have a mailbox too. Whoever the newcomers are, because you know who you are. Look in your mailbox. Any others?
One announcement is that we do have the International Potluck following the Sunday school hour around 12 o'clock. Today at the church, it'll be downstairs, and so we'll get to taste hopefully a lot of dishes from other countries, some we've had and some we haven't had. So I'm excited to see a lot of you there.
Our Sunday school study of Luke will begin after worship, probably in the foyer. And if any of you are interested, this week, Wednesday evening, 6:30 to 8:30, I'm doing a special session at the retreat center up at on Wawasee Lake in Syracuse. And you're invited, there's no cost. They ask you to pre-register. If you're interested, I can get you the contact information.
For call to worship, I come across a short little reading I'd like to share with you. Serving God is one of the most important principles of the Christian faith. As believers, we're expected to help the church with a joyful spirit, to love one another, to care for one another, to pray for one another, to encourage one another, counsel one another, support one another. One of the scriptures that tell us that the relationship to God and others through service. We must remember that serving others may not always be easy, but we will be rewarded for our efforts. Remember that nothing is too small that God cannot use. Many Bible verses about serving encourage your spirit and strengthen your heart and mind. Thank you, Lord, for opportunity to gather here as your body in this house today, that we may seek your will and your spirit move among us, that we may be willing, more eager to reach out and serve other people. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Amen. Song number one. Page number one. This comes a time in our worship where you can be a part of it, sharing your concerns and joys with the concerns that you might have. Let's pray this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and mercy and your everlasting love you share with each one of us in this room. How you move in our hearts, how you move in our midst is a mystery, but we say thank you. Brother Mary's various spoken of healing and going home from hospitals. We give you thanks for that. Thanks, Lord, for your magic, your magic in healing our bodies in wonderful ways. That's hard to believe. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunities for you to come and worship you, and give you the praise and honor that you deserve. You are our King, you are our Lord, you died for us, you rose again, that we may have eternal life. Help us to not keep that secret to ourselves, but to share it with people around us in ways that make it very apparent to who we are and what we are. Thanks, Lord. Bless Audri today as she delivers her message. Give her the ability to speak, but she's decided to tell us, give her the freedom of word. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. For our offering this morning, we have the regular offering of 5 cents a meal. And is there a thing for Cap Mac, or we do that next Sunday? Cap Mac's the focus. Look at that magic. We got three things up here. The upside down. There you go. That's for Camp Matt. Gracious God, you gave us life. Now we give our lives back to you represent our lives, our work and play, our joys and sorrows, our thoughts and deeds, our gifts and resources, to be used by you for the sake of all people everywhere. You can come forward if you wish and bring your offerings forward. Thank you, God, the ability to give a portion of what we have. Use these gifts in a way pleasing to you to further your kingdom here and beyond. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing 575. It's time for children's, for the little ones and any ones that are young at heart. Come on up.
Maybe you could tell me, what is this a picture of? A lamb. It is. It's a baby sheep. And at the top it says, Jesus is my shepherd. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. But I brought something odd about this lamb. What do lambs usually have all over the outside of them? Yeah, fur, wool. And this lamb doesn't have any. So I thought maybe we could give him some. And I brought some fluff and some glue sticks, and I wonder if we could give this lamb some wool. What do you think? In our story for today that we're going to hear from the Bible, Jesus tells everybody that he is a shepherd, and we are a sheep. And I wonder, Harvey, Andrew, are you technically a shepherd? Harvey's dad is a shepherd, and shepherds take care of sheep, and they take care of us too. And that's what Jesus does. As our shepherd, he takes care of us, and he makes sure that we are always safe and protected and loved. And so, thank you for helping me give this sheep some wool. What do you think, Harvey? You want to put some on there? Let's have a quick prayer. Maybe we can finish giving him some wool later. Dear God, thank you for giving us Jesus, your son, to be our shepherd and to take care of us and make sure we're always safe. Amen.
The scripture this morning is from John 10, 14 to 30. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this lot, not of this pen. I must bring them along also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay my life down only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay my life down of my own accord. I have the authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. The Jews who heard these words were divided again. Many of them said, "He is demon-possessed and raving mad. Why listen to him?" But others said, "These are not the sayings of a man who is possessed by a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind?" Then came the festival of the dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple courts walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews who were there gathered around him, saying, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you were the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I did tell you, but you did not believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify about me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will ever snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand, and I and the Father are one."
Audri, I think you could talk on that passage for a month.
Why did Jesus choose to call himself a shepherd? Obviously, Jesus had done carpentry. He had dabbled in fishing, but we don't have any recorded scenes in the Bible where Jesus is literally herding sheep. This is one of his famous metaphors, the storytelling method that he loved so much. He was very specifically chosen to call himself a shepherd, over every other occupation, to share an important truth about himself and about God. So why a shepherd? Here's the history. In biblical times, the law as laid down in the book of Exodus, from the 22nd chapter, verses 10 and 11, reads, "If anyone gives a donkey, an ox, or a sheep, or any other animal to their neighbor for safekeeping," and shepherds did fall in this category because they were often paid to care for other people's sheep, "and it dies, or is injured, or is taken away while no one is looking, the issue between them will be settled by taking an oath before the Lord that the neighbor did not lay hands on the other person's property. The owner is to accept this, and no restitution is required." What this means is if the sheep died or was injured, and the shepherd could prove that he wasn't there at the time, or it was not in his control to have protected the sheep, he had to swear before God that this was the truth. And the owner of the sheep was to trust the integrity of the shepherd. The shepherd would not lie because lying would be lying before God. So as verse 12 continues, but if the animal was stolen from the neighbor, restitution must be made to the owner. And restitution for a stolen sheep wouldn't just be repayment to get another sheep. It could be twice as much if the sheep was found, or four times as much if the sheep was never returned. And if the shepherd couldn't prove that he wasn't the one who took the sheep, and he didn't have the money to pay, it was written that he himself could be sold to repay the debt. There was only one way for the shepherd to avoid paying restitution for a sheep that was lost under his watch. That is, if the shepherd could prove that he did everything in his power to prevent the loss of the sheep. In verse 13, it says, if it was torn to pieces by a wild animal, the neighbor shall bring in the remains as evidence, and shall not be required to pay for the torn animal. So if wild animals or thieves tried to steal the sheep on the shepherd's watch, it was the duty of the shepherd to fight to save the sheep, alive or dead, as proof that he had done all he could. The shepherd's job was dangerous, even laying down his life for the sheep. So if you fast forward to our scripture from John, chapter 10, the 14th and 15th verses, when Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. In that metaphor, the people of God were under Jesus' care and keeping. So for them to fall to sin and suffering on his watch was inexcusable unless he did everything in his power to save them. When we think about Jesus as the good shepherd, it isn't just in a guiding and nurturing way, but the kind of self-sacrificial caretaking that led to his death for our sake. Then, crucially, Jesus' metaphor does not end there. In verse 16, Jesus continues, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. So at first, we're thinking of the people of God as Jesus' sheep. At the time, God's chosen people were the Israelites, definitely not the Gentiles, definitely not the Samaritans, definitely not anyone else other than the Israelites who believed. But Jesus says, I have other sheep. I must bring them also. Today is World Communion Sunday. It's an 80-year-old tradition of churches across the world, across denominations, participating in Holy Communion together. The credit for beginning World Communion Sunday goes to a Presbyterian minister, Dr. Hugh Thompson Kerr. His younger son, the Reverend Dr. Donald Craig Kerr, talked about the origin of World Communion Sunday, and he said this, "The concept spread very slowly at first. People didn't give it a whole lot of thought. It was during the Second World War that the spirit caught hold because we were trying to hold the world together. Worldwide communion symbolized the effort to hold things together in a spiritual sense. It emphasized that we are one in the spirit and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Communion, by nature, is a unifying experience, although it has a deeply personal component between the individual and God. When Jesus first broke the bread and poured the wine for his disciples, he was unifying them to continue his work in the world. None was above the others. All were blessed by God. And their task as disciples was to seek others and bring them also. To live their lives following Jesus' example to the best of their abilities. Jesus set the example. In times of greatest fear and suffering, like the night he knew he must die and leave those he loved to carry on, people must come together, not tear apart. The history of World Communion Sunday demonstrates that. Let's talk about a slightly more recent example of a man who knew and followed Jesus' call during a time of war and great suffering. Some of you may be familiar with Ted Studebaker. Ted Studebaker was a graduate of Manchester University with a sociology and psychology major who went on to get his social work degree. He was in his 20s when the Vietnam War and draft began. Ted was raised in the Church of the Brethren. He was against all war because he felt that killing others could not lead to peace. So rather than fight in the war, he chose to meet the draft requirements as a conscientious objector. He was sent to Vietnam through Church World Service to help in the war-torn communities there as an agriculturist. He had worked on his family farm of 140 acres in southern Ohio while growing up. So that was an area he felt equipped to serve others. Ted Studebaker served 2 years in Vietnam and even got married to a Chinese woman who was also serving in that same area with him. Only 6 days after they were married and agreed to stay on and help for a third year, the Viet Cong attacked the place they were staying, and Ted Studebaker was shot point blank and died. He was 25 years old. One of the last things that he did was write a letter. On the day he died, he had just written this letter in response to a rather harsh letter someone from his home congregation had written him. Someone who felt he was being unchristian in so adamantly opposing the war. Even in response to this direct denouncement of his character, Ted Studebaker stayed compassionate and positive to the end. I'm going to read the conclusion to his final letter. He wrote, "I believe strongly in trying to follow the example of Jesus Christ as best I know how. Above all, Christ taught me to love all people, including enemies, and to return good for evil, and that all men are brothers in Christ. I condemn all war and conscientiously refuse to take part in it in any active or violent way. I believe love is a stronger and more enduring power than hatred for my fellow man, regardless of who or what they believe. Please know I am in excellent health and adequate security. I know I am a fortunate man, and life is great to me." The people closest to Ted said he was wise beyond his years. Ted knew what Jesus was talking about. It is not just war or violence that separates God's people. It is hatred, bitterness, apathy, jealousy, whatever gets in the way of loving God and neighbor. So it isn't enough to say Jesus died for us so we should die for others. Jesus died for us so we could live for others in remembrance of him. So we could live lives of compassion, listening to one another, sharing with one another, carrying one another when life gets too heavy. In Thomas Porter's book, The spirit and art of conflict transformation, creating a culture of just peace. He writes, according to Matthew 18, 7 through 9, we need to cut out that portion of our lives that is getting in the way of our experiencing the kingdom. Whether it is idolatry involving money, sex, or possessions, whatever distracts you from the love of God and neighbor. He continues, unless we follow this journey of conversion, the cycle of woundedness, retribution, and violence continue. This is the journey of those who gather at the table of Holy Communion, a table of reconciliation and restorative justice. As part of this process of cutting out what is getting between us and love of God and our neighbors, Porter suggests an exercise that I will invite you to join me in doing this morning if you wish to participate. It involves the envelopes with paper in them that you all may have received. If you don't have one, don't worry. I'm going to describe Porter's exercise now, but we're going to wait to do it until we've reached the service of communion. Porter recommends identifying something that you personally feel you need to remove from your life to break a cycle of woundedness or to clear your heart. This is something that only you can identify. And it doesn't have to be like Lent, where it's a physical thing, although it can be, but this is less about the rules and more about your own spiritual well-being. If you carry guilt, what is the cause? And is there a deeper cause than that, even? If you carry grief, is there something you cannot let go of? Why do you feel the need to cling so tightly? If you're holding hatred close to your heart, who is your hatred hurting the most? Is it causing you to suffer also? For now, I just want you to think about what that removal from love might be for you. It can be as specific as you want it to be. And when we've reached that point in the service of communion, I will invite you to write it down on the piece of paper inside the envelope and then return it to the envelope before you go up to take your communion. This exercise is meant to be just between yourself and God. Porter suggests keeping the envelope afterward and periodically opening it to evaluate how you're doing in removing what you have written down from your life. I think that could be one wise choice. However, since this is between you and God, you can do whatever you want with your envelope. You can seal it away. You can tear it up. The paper and the envelope are not as important as the choice to take a step closer to God. As we enter into this time of communion, you will see up at the front, there are two tables with bread and cups. There will be a deacon at each table, so there can be two lines going up. Each deacon will give you bread and a blessing to eat, and then you can pick up a cup and drink. In just a moment, I will invite the deacons to come forward. And our incredible pianist for this morning, I believe, will be playing some music during this time. When he begins to play, I welcome you to then write on your paper and place it in your envelope. Or if you are unable to write, spend a moment of time in prayer with God about what in your life may be hurting your spiritual well-being. Then once you have done that, come up to receive the bread and cup. As we reflect in this time on Jesus as the good shepherd who gave his life that we may be redeemed, may this bread be as Jesus' body, broken for you, the communion of the body of Christ. May this cup that has been poured out for you be as the blood of Jesus, a covenant of communion in remembrance of his sacrifice. Please join me in praying. Lord, we pray that you may bless this time of communion. We know you are present with us. When we face obstacles that seem too big to overcome, you give us strength. You know our hearts, our faults, our fears, and our brokenness, but you offer everlasting love through the example of Jesus, who laid down his life for us. Through the brokenness of his body, we can find healing. Through the spilling of his blood, we are called to seek peace. Let us remember all the people around the world who are taking part in communion this day, who are praying as we are, that your depths of love may be fully realized in this world. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. May the deacons please come forward. Thank you. We will now have a closing hymn, number 456, Shepherd of Souls Refresh. So I will read the last line marked leader, and you will read the final line marked all. In benediction, above all, may we want to know Christ. May we be found in his grace, transformed by his love. Christ has made us his own. Thanks be to God.